Explain the general program and motivation for why you want to study off-shell amplitudes and in particular 1-pi amplitudes. Okay. And our eventual goal, of course, will be to study superstring theory and superstrings and heterotic strings. But today I'll do a warm-up exercise, okay, using bosonic string theory, because some of the things are simpler, of course, in bosonic string theory. But as you know, it's not really fully consistent because of the presence of the tachyon. So let me begin by reminding you of the tasks that we have to do perform in order to carry out this program. Okay. And this is the slide that I showed you at the end of yesterday's lecture. So the first goal will be to find a parameterization of the space PGN and its tangent space. So PGN, let me remind you, is the total space of the moduli space of a genus G Riemann surface with n punctures. Okay. Together with the choice of local coordinates around each of these n punctures. Okay, that's the space PGN. So PGN contains information about where you are in the moduli space as well as what kind of local coordinate system you have chosen. The next task was that for any n given external states, not necessarily on-shell or BRST invariant states, and these n external states we collectively denoted as some phi. We want to construct a P form omega P on this space PGN with the desired properties. Okay, and the desired property is this one. Okay. Namely, if we replace the argument of omega P by QB acting on phi, where QB is the sum of the BRST charges acting on all the states, then it satisfies an identity that relates it to a P minus 1 form, omega P minus 1 acted on by the exterior derivative. And the final task was to construct Bloom compatible sections and 1 pi subspaces of PGN. Okay, so these Bloom compatible sections are what we call SGN, and given SGN we also introduce the notion of 1 pi subspaces, which I call RGN. Okay. And hopefully some of these things will become clearer as we carry out explicit examples today. So are there any questions on this program? Pardon? True for any? Any phi. Yes, yes. So phi is some any general state which is in the product of n Hilbert spaces, right? There are n external states, so that takes value in the product of n Hilbert spaces. Okay. And it's true for any phi, yes. Okay. So that is not, we'll introduce the Hilbert spaces first and then we'll take phi to be an arbitrary state in that Hilbert space. No, no. Because on on-shell states, of course, this will be 0. Right? So it's for a general state. We are not assuming phi to be on-shell. Pardon? P? P is any arbitrary integer. Right? So we'll construct this omega p's for every value of P. Okay, even though we'll actually use it only for few values of P, but we'll give this construction for an arbitrary P. No, omega p, this is an argument of omega p, right? It depends on the state in this Hilbert, product of Hilbert space. But omega p is a p form valued in PGN.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
P form on that?
On that space.
That space, but it's valid in the dual space, the tensor product of Hilbert space. Given phi, you get some.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Yeah, so you get a real number given phi, or a complex number given phi, yes. Okay, so let me begin by giving a description of PGN, okay, in particular how we parameterize PGN. Okay. So PGN, let me remind you again, is so any given point in PGN labels where in the moduli space you are in as well as what kind of local coordinate system you have chosen around the punctures. Right? That's the meaning of PGN, having a point in PGN. Okay. So let's suppose that you have a Riemann surface. Okay, so here I have different disk, this is a Riemann surface with two holes, okay, and two punctures. Okay. But given any Riemann surface of genus G and n punctures, okay, it's easy to see that we can consider this as a union of n disks Okay, so each of these end discs are cut out around these end punctures. So around each of these punctures you cut out a disc. Okay, so it's a union of end discs, which I'll denote by DA, and 2G minus 2 plus n spheres, which I'll denote by SI. Each of them have 3 holes. Okay. Now this number counting, it takes a little thought to see that these are the correct numbers. Okay. But this figure illustrates what we are doing. So around each of these punctures, this is a puncture here and this is a puncture here, we cut out a disc which I had called D1 and D2. Okay. And then the rest of the Riemann surface I just decompose, okay, into spheres with 3 holes by drawing circles. Okay. We just cut the Riemann surface along arbitrary circles of this kind, okay, so that it splits up into collection of spheres and discs. Okay. And you can count that the number of spheres that will have is 2g minus 2 plus n. So for example, here in this example, we have g equal to 2, it is a genus 2 Riemann surface, we have n equal to 2. So you expect 4 spheres, and indeed we have 4 spheres, S1, S2, S3, S4. And you would see that each of these spheres have 3 holes. Okay. And you can also count that there will be 3g minus 3 plus 2n circles which form boundaries between these different regions. Okay. So there are some circles which form the boundary between discs and spheres, and some other circles which form the boundary between 2 spheres. Okay, and this counting again is a simple exercise that you can carry out. Okay, in this particular example, okay, this number I think is 7, right? G is 2, so 3 times 2 is 6 minus 3, that's 3 plus 2n, that's 4. Right? So this number is 7, and you can see precisely there are 7 circles over here. So is this clear? So this is just a geometric fact that a Riemann surface you can think of as a collection of discs and spheres, okay, glued at their boundaries. Okay. So now given this kind of decomposition, we introduce WAs, which I call the complex coordinates on DA. Okay. And we will choose a convention that see each of these DAs surround a puncture, right? Eighth puncture. So D1 surrounds the puncture number 1, D2 here surrounds the puncture number 2. Okay. So WAs will call the complex coordinates on DA, and we will choose the convention that the eighth puncture is situated at the origin of the W coordinate system. Okay. This is the convention we have been following yesterday, and we will follow it today as well. Okay. And on each of the spheres, we can introduce complex coordinates, which I will call ZI. Okay, so you have complex coordinates on each sphere, complex coordinates on each disk. Okay. And it's clear now that if SI and DA share a common boundary, then on that boundary you have some functional relationship that relates ZI with WA. Okay, because these are holomorphic coordinates, so this is a holomorphic function that relates them. Okay, it's of course holomorphic only around that circle. Okay, it can have singularities elsewhere. Okay. And similarly, if SI and SJ share a common boundary, then on this boundary, we have a functional relationship that relates ZI and ZJ. Okay, those I'll call Fij. Okay, so given a Riemann surface, we can always find these functions from this. Okay, that giving these functions is the meaning of telling you what a Riemann surface is, what Riemann surface you are considering. Are there any questions on this? Okay, so these functions, okay, in fact, contain complete information on the Riemann surface and the choice of local coordinates. Okay, so once you are given these functions, okay, that's equivalent to giving the Riemann surface, okay, in MGN, what particular point in MGN you are at, and also what local coordinate system you have chosen, right? Because this contains information about the W's, okay, and W's are the local coordinates around the punctures. So a given point in PGN, so giving a point in PGN is equivalent to giving all these transition functions. Okay. And the number of such transition functions is the number of circles which we had counted as 3G minus 3 plus 2N. Okay. So 3G minus 2N, 3 plus 2N functions, okay, will specify the Riemann surface as well as the choice of local coordinates. So this gives a characterization of PGN, so we can choose as coordinates of PGN these functions. Okay, of course it's an infinite dimensional space, okay, which we already expect. Okay, so it's a space of these functions which describes PGN. Okay, but it's not the full set of functions that describe PGN because there is a lot of redundancy. Okay, in this description, okay. And the redundancy comes from the fact that if we make any parameterization of the zi's, okay, suppose you change the coordinate system zi to something else, okay, that is not going to change the Riemann surface, okay, it's just a change of coordinate system, okay. Neither is it going to change the choice of local coordinates on the disks because those are the W coordinates, okay. So that means that given these functions, okay, there is a set of equivalence relation that is induced by reparametrization of the zi's. Okay, of course, these reparametrizations will have to map those spheres into spheres, right? If it is singular inside the sphere, then it is not a valid reparametrization. Okay, but there is a lot of freedom here. Okay, you can reparametrize your zi and you get back the same Riemann surface. Is this point clear? Now, in general, if we reparametrize the W's, okay, they will give different points in PGN. Right? In fact, reparametrizing W's will keep you at the same point in the moduli space, okay, but it will take you to a different point on PGN because changing W corresponds to changing the local coordinate system. Okay? So, reparametrization of W is not an equivalence relation. Okay? However, we have to declare that if we just change W by a phase, okay, suppose you consider the parameters where WA goes to some phase times WA, okay, then these are defined to give the same point in PGN, okay, which basically means that what I told you earlier, okay, was not completely correct. I said that PGN labels a point on the Riemann on the moduli space as well as the choice of local coordinates. Okay. What PGN specifies in fact is a point on the moduli space and the choice of local coordinates up to phases. Okay, phases don't count. If two choices of local coordinates differ by a phase, we declare them as being same point in PGN. Okay, and this is necessary for this program to work because yesterday there was a question of whether it's possible to choose a section. Okay, we needed a section for carrying out the integral of omega. Okay, and one can show that the sections don't exist. Okay, if you include in the description of PGA information about the phase. Okay, it's impossible to choose a section, okay, that also keeps track of the phase. Okay, so you have to forget about the phases, okay, and only under that condition that we can define, we can find a section in PGN. Okay, so this is something that we impose explicitly, okay, and you have to there is a price to pay, which I'll come back later. Yes, so it is enough that if you choose, if you just say that a change of constant phase, okay, is identified, that you identify different points in PGN, I mean apparently different points related by this constant phases as the same point, okay, that is enough for us to find a section. Okay, you don't need any further identification. Okay, you can try to do further identification, but that will restrict yourself to smaller Hilbert space. Okay, as you will see that this already will restrict your Hilbert space to be not the full Hilbert space of the conformal field theory, but a subspace. Okay, and I will describe what subspace you have to consider. Right? The more condition you put on this W, right, the restriction comes from the fact that then the states that you consider in the Hilbert space must be invariant under that reparametrization. Right? So you don't want to impose too many constraints because you want a general off-shell state. Okay, are there any other questions? Yes. Yeah, so the fact that you are integrating theta from 0 to 2 pi, right, basically means that the phase doesn't matter, right. Whatever phase you have chosen for this W, right, if you have chosen another phase, okay, you will get the same result after you carry out the integral over theta from 0 to 2 pi.
So this is the same ambiguity.
Yes, so this says that theta is ambiguous, but as long as you are integrating over the whole range of theta, if this ambiguity is irrelevant, right? You pick any coordinates, any local coordinate W, right? Fix some phase, right? If you had chosen a different phase, that will correspond to a different theta. But after you have integrated over theta, the result is unchanged.
One more question.
Yes.
Like regarding the parameterization of the PGN.
Yes.
Give an example.
Yes. Yes. Well, no, number you cannot vary. The choice of spheres and circles you could vary. Right? So you pick some particular choice of spheres and circles. Well, the what I said is that you, this is just a convention that you choose three punctured spheres. Right? A spheres with three holes. You can say as long as you choose spheres with three holes, right, then the number is fixed. Yes, you could, right? Then you will use a different parameterization of the of PGN, right? This is just one particular way to parameterize PGN, but there are other parameterizations. It's not, I'm not saying that this is the only way to parameterize PGN. Is this clear? Okay. So this is just a way that you parameterize your space PGN. Okay. Because yesterday I think a lot of people asked about the space PGN. This is a concrete description of what you mean by PGN. Okay, it's a collection, it's an information that contains information about all these functions, okay, up to these three parameterizations. Okay, now it turns out that we also need to parameterize tangent vectors of PGN. Okay, it's not just enough to specify a coordinate system on PGN, but it's also useful to understand tangent vectors of PGN because you have to define forms on PGN, right? And for those, for defining forms, it will be useful to keep track of tangent vectors. Okay. So what are tangent vectors? In any space, right, a tangent vector corresponds to infinitesimal deformation, okay, of coordinates. So you have to understand what you mean by infinitesimal deformation of the coordinate of PGN. Okay, you go from one point in PGN to a neighboring point. Okay, how do you do that? You do that by changing these functions by infinitesimal amount. Okay. So take for example these functions FIA, right? We can take a given FIA and we change it by an infinitesimal amount which we call delta FIA. Okay. So this means that if the original relationship was ZI equal to some function FIA of WA, then the new relationship will be ZI as FIA of WA minus delta FIA of WA. And these changes, okay, so this delta FI is naturally a function of WA, but I can re-express it in terms of Z by simply relating WA in terms of Z, right? It's the inverse relation is WA is FIA inverse ZI. So that's how I've written delta FIA of FIA inverse ZI. Okay. So this is an infinitesimal vector field on the Riemann surface, right? Because this is telling you a small change in ZI. Okay. Not everywhere, but on that particular circle, right? Because this transition function is well defined only on a particular circle that forms a boundary between dA and SI. Okay. So let me draw the figure here. Okay. So here you have a circle. Okay. On one side of the circle you have dA, on the other side you have the SI. Okay. Let's say this is the dA is the interior, SI is the exterior. Okay. And FIA tells you how to match the coordinates inside with the coordinates outside. Okay. Change in FIA, okay, is a small change in ZI for a fixed W, right? So a change in FIA will correspond to a small change in the relationship between ZI and WA. Okay. And that you can think of as a vector field, okay, defined around the circle. Okay. So the vector field that you have defining this way is non-singular around this circle, okay. But if you try to analytically continue it either outside or inside, okay, you may run into poles, singularities. Okay, we don't care. All we need to know is that vector field is well defined along this circle. Okay, so those changes, those kinds of vector fields parameterize infinitesimal deformations of coordinates of P, and hence they label the tangent vectors. Is this point clear? Okay, so tangent vectors of PGN are infinitesimal deformations of the coordinates of PGN, and this is the way you characterize infinitesimal deformations. Okay, so let me summarize the lesson again. So the lesson is that the infinitesimal deformations of PGN are characterized by the tangent vectors of PGN are characterized by infinitesimal vector fields defined along these boundaries articles, okay, along these various CIs that I have introduced. Is this point clear? Yes, you can.
But it doesn't produce additional tangent
vectors. Well, it's a change in FIA, right? Now you can think of this as a change in ZI for fixed W or change in W for fixed Z. Right? So the because the functions the which label PGN are these functions, FIA and FIJ. Right? So what you change are these functions. Okay. And now you have to reinterpret this, okay, what that function means, what changing that function means. Right? It is a change in the relationship between W and Z. You can either think of this as a change in Z for a fixed W or change in W for a fixed Z. Right? It gives the same vector fields. As a vector field, it's not, there is no difference. Is this point clear? Okay. Now, again, this is a redundant description, okay, because there are some changes, okay, which are induced just by reparametrizing ZIs. Okay, I told you earlier that reparametrizing ZIs don't move in PGN, right? They leave you at the same point in PGN, okay, because that's just a change of coordinate system. Okay. Nevertheless, if you keep the W's fixed and you reparametrize Z's, okay, then these functions will change. Then in general, imagine that we have, let's draw this sphere with three holes, okay, here is our ZI, okay, and there are various three transition functions here, okay. If we reparameterize ZI, okay, that will change the transition functions here, the transition functions here, and the transition functions here. So that's some general linear combination of the vector fields, one vector field here, one vector field here, and one vector field here. Okay. So that should be declared as zero tangent vector, right? Because reparametrizing Z doesn't change the coordinate system, the coordinate of PGN, right? This is a gauge transformation in some sense. Okay. So those kind of the changes that are induced, the changes in these functions that are induced by these reparametrizations should be declared as zero tangent vector. Okay. So, not every vector field on CI represents independent tangent vectors of PGN. There is a relationship between these tangent vectors, okay, which correspond to reparametrizing the ZIs. Okay. And the same is true, of course, in changing the phase of W. Okay. Tangent vectors which are induced by changing the phase of W should be declared as zero tangent vector. Is this point clear? So this is what I have said here. These must be declared as zero tangent vectors of PGN. Okay. So this is basically all you need to know about how to parameterize PGN, okay, and the tangent space of PGN. Okay. In fact, what is going to be important is the parameterization of the tangent space. So now we move to the next task, okay, namely construction of this P form on PGN. Okay. So for this, let me remind you again that if you have a bosonic string theory, okay, it's based on a matter conformal field theory of central charge 26 and a ghost conformal field theory of C equal to minus 26. Okay. And in particular, this ghost conformal field theory contains four sets of ghosts, okay, B, C and B bar, C bar. So, B and C are holomorphic and B bar and C bar are anti-holomorphic ghost fields. Okay. Now, these ghost fields, as in any conformal field theory, okay, these are holomorphic and anti-holomorphic fields. So, we can decompose this into modes. Okay, we can, for example, we can decompose B of Z as sum over n bn z to the minus n minus 2. Okay, these are have conformal order 2, and c of z, these have conformal order 1, minus 1. So here the decomposition is cn z to the minus n plus 1. Okay. So bn's and zn, cn's are thus operators in the Hilbert space, okay, of this conformal field theory. So what is going to be important for us are B0, okay, and maybe I should also write the expansion of T, the energy momentum tensor. Okay. This has weight 2, so this expansion is ln z to the minus n minus 2. Okay. And similarly, there is a expansion for the B bar, C bar, and T bar, where all of these are replaced by their bar counterpart. Okay. So, we will consider H, we will define H as a Hilbert space of this combined CFT, okay, but we will not allow for a general state in this Hilbert space. Okay. We will work with a restricted class of states, okay, and that will be included in the definition of H. Okay. Those are the states which are annihilated by this combination B0 minus B0 bar and L0 minus L0 bar. Okay. And these conditions are necessary, okay, because in the definition of PGN, okay, we allowed, we identified local coordinate systems up to phases, right. We say that if W and W e to the I alpha times W, okay, these two local choice of local coordinate systems are declared as the same point in PGN, okay. And this is guaranteed, okay, that this is in order that we get a sensible result, we have to impose these conditions. Okay. For example, L0 minus L0 bar, right? What does it do? Okay. L0 minus L0 bar essentially is a rotation acting on the state. Okay. And because this annihilates the state, okay, it shows that whether you choose a local coordinate system W or e to the I alpha times W, it makes no difference. Right? The state doesn't know about it because the two choices are related by L0 minus L0 bar action. Okay. So, the fact that we have defined PGN, okay, by saying that W and e to the I alpha times W correspond to the same point in PGN requires us to impose this condition. Okay, and we will see that there is a similar reason why we have to impose also annihilation by this. Are there any questions on this? So, given this Hilbert space H, we will denote by H to the n, the n-fold tensor product of H. This is needed because if you want to compute the n-point amplitude, right, then you need n external states, which of course naturally take value in this n-fold tensor product. Okay. And I will also denote by this the BPZ inner product between CFT states. Okay. If you have not seen it before, it is basically a two-point function on the sphere. Okay. So, if you take a sphere with the vortex operators A and B inserted. Okay. So, AB is basically this. Okay. You put one at 0, one at infinity, and that is what you define as this inner product. Okay, so now we will start defining our omegas. Okay. So let us consider some point in PGN. Okay, again, giving a point in PGN means that you have specified all the transition functions. Okay, the moduli space is, you have picked a point on the moduli space and also the choice of local coordinates. Okay. So this corresponds to a Riemann surface S of genus G and n punctures, and it also contains information about the choice of local coordinates at each puncture, right. That is what I mean by saying we pick a point in PGN. Okay. And again, when I say a choice of local coordinates, it is understood that I am referring to choice of local coordinates up to phases. Okay. We forget the phase information. Okay. And now suppose you are given a state phi in this product Hilbert space, which means a collection of n states, okay, each of which satisfies these conditions that B0 minus B0 bar annihilates it and L0 minus L0 bar annihilates it. Then we define by this symbol phi s Okay. Just as a correlation function of this n vortex operators of phi on the Riemann surface, okay, and the vortex operators are inserted with the chosen local coordinate system. Okay. The standard conformal field theory methods tells you how to calculate these kinds of correlation functions on arbitrary Riemann surface. Okay. This is a standard technology in two-dimensional CFT that if you are given a set of vortex operators, if you are given a Riemann surface, okay, and if you are told how to insert these vortex operators on the Riemann surface, okay, if the vortex operators are not conformally invariant, okay, the result will depend on how you insert them, okay, in what coordinate system or in what equivalently in what metric you put near the punctures. Once all that information is given, okay, the standard conformal field theory technology tells you how to compute the one point function or the not one n point function on this Riemann surface, and that is solitary denoted by phi s. And now we define our omega 0 of phi, the 0 form, okay, simply as this quantity phi s, okay, the n point correlation function on this Riemann surface s, but with this normalization factor. Okay, this normalization factor is necessary to get these various identities right.
This phi physical on shell space?
No, off shell. I am not assuming phi to be on shell, right, because as I said phi is an arbitrary state in the Hilbert space, okay, which only satisfying these conditions, right, these are not on shell conditions, right, on shell condition will correspond to qb acting on phi equal to 0, okay, and a particular representative will require that L0 and L0 bar, okay, annihilate the state and also all the Ln's annihilate the state, right, if you want to have a primary state representation. So none of those conditions are imposed, so phi is a general off shell state. Are there any other questions? Yes.
When you say that the n point function is calculable,
means
in a given theory?
Yes.
In this given theory.
Yeah. So you have to give the conformal field theory, right? Take for example, suppose you have bosonic string theory in 26 flat space time dimension, right? Then the conformal field theory is a free field theory, right? And in that theory, you know how to compute it. If you are given a Welzuminoeten theory, right, then the conformal field theory is interacting, but again there are standard techniques which tells you how to compute this correlation function on the Riemann surface.
Okay.
No, no, just conformal invariance is not going to fix it, yeah. Certainly, even on the sphere, right, the conformal invariance does not fix anything other than the form of 3-point function, right. From 4-point function onwards, there is a non-trivial information in the conformal field theory. Even the spectrum, the conformal weights, allowed conformal weights differ from one conformal field theory to another conformal field theory. So certainly conformal field theory, a generic conformal field theory will not tell you what the answer is, right, but once you are given a specific conformal field theory, there are standard techniques which tells you how to compute this, right, and that is what you want to do, right, in string, when you want to calculate amplitudes in string theory, right, you first fix a background and you calculate S matrix in that given background. Are there any other questions? Okay, now we turn to a more complicated story. We have to specify omega p, right? I only gave you omega 0, which are simple, just one, the n point function on the Riemann surface. What is omega p? Okay, so before I say what is omega p, let me try to describe what does that mean by specifying a p form, right? A p form is not a number, right? So how do you specify a p form, right? What is the meaning of giving omega p? Okay. And one way of giving a p form on a generic manifold is the following. So let's suppose that we have some arbitrary space, okay, labeled by coordinates x, okay, and if you have chosen a coordinate system, then a p form can be specified in this way, I1 to ip dx I1 wedge dxip. Okay, this is what one means by a p form. Okay. And if we give the components of omega, okay, then that corresponds to specifying the p form. But this requires choosing a specific coordinate system. Now, there is an equivalent but a slightly different way of specifying a p form, which is the following. So, suppose we consider a vector field, okay, a vector field in a, on a on this space will take the form Vi del del xi. Okay, this is a vector field. Okay, on the same manifold. Suppose we have, so this I'll call V. Okay, V is defined to be this. So suppose you have P vector fields. Okay, so for example, V1 is V1 I del del xi. V2 is V2 I del del xi, and so on. In this case, you can define something called the contraction of the p form with these vector fields. Omega v on to vp is defined essentially as omega I1 to ip vi1 to vip. Okay, this is the definition of contraction of omega with these p vector fields. Okay. And if I tell you how to compute this for every any arbitrary choice of p vector fields, okay, that's equivalent to giving omega, right? If I tell you how to compute this for any arbitrary choice of p vector fields, okay, then that's equivalent to specifying this components omega I1 to ip. Okay, even though we have now we are choosing a specific coordinate system to label omega. Is this point clear? Yeah, so, specifying a p form means we have to specify how to contract it with p vector fields, p arbitrarily chosen vector fields. Okay. And this is easier to specify because this is a number. Okay. So, what I will tell you now is on this PGN, okay, when I say I'll define what omega p is, okay, what I will tell you is how to construct the contraction of omega p with any arbitrary set of p vector fields on PGN. Okay. And this is the definition. Yes. No, no, okay. So, yeah, yeah. So, the phi, omega, all of these p forms are functions of this product of n Hilbert spaces, right? That is always there, right? So, so I can write it this way. Yes, exactly. So, this is a different thing altogether, right? It's always, you have to first specify your phi and that gives you omega p, right? But now, on top of that, this omega p, okay, will be contracted with this V vector fields. Well, it's a linear map, right? I don't know whether one should call it. No, omega doesn't have any additional index. Okay, omega is a complex number. This is a complex number. That given phi, you get a number. Let's go back to omega zero, okay? Where this confusion doesn't arise. Okay, this says that given phi, it is just giving a number, right? That's what it means. Right? This is omega zero, right? This is not a vector, right? This is are no other index, right? This is just a number, complex number.
But omega is also linear in phi.
Yes, omega is linear in phi. Yes.
It's also a linear map from the tensor
two complex numbers. Yes, exactly. Yeah, but I mean the point is there is no hidden index anywhere here, right? Yes, if you remove the phi, then there is a hidden index. Yes, okay. But once you put the phi, then there is no hidden index. Yeah, you are right. Okay, any other questions? Okay, so what I have tried to explain here is that giving omega, okay, giving a P form, okay, basically means that you have to specify how to contract it with P vector fields. Okay. Now, let us recall that the tangent vectors of P, okay, they are labeled by vector fields Vi on the Riemann surface around these circles. Okay. So, given a tangent vector Vi of PGN, okay, we pick the corresponding vector fields Vi on the Riemann surface, okay, because each tangent vector is labeled by one or more of these Vi's around these separating circles CSI. Okay. And we define this operator, okay, which is just a contour integral of these ghosts, B ghosts and anti-B ghosts, okay, B bar ghosts, weighted by Vi and Vi bar. Okay, and these are naturally integrated because B of z, okay, has dimension 2, okay, Vi being a vector field has dimension minus 1. So, this is a dimension 1 object which can be integrated along a contour. Okay, so, this is independent of how you parameterize the coordinate z. So, this is the definition of B of Vi. Okay, and if there are P such vector fields, for each such vector field, you can introduce this operator B of Vi. Okay. And now, I give you the omega P of phi contracted with this, sorry, this should have been P. Okay, it is not Vn, it is Vp. Okay. Omega P of phi contracted with this P vector fields, okay, any set of P vector fields that you can choose, because every vector field has a representation like this, okay, is given by this correlation function. Okay, so here it is not simple correlation function of the external vortex operators, you also need to insert a set of B ghosts in this form. Okay. So, this means that given any P tangent vectors of PGN, okay, I have told you how to get a number, okay, how to compute the contraction of omega with those tangent vectors, okay, and that is equivalent to giving omega. Yes. How do you see the anti-symmetry? Well, it is easy because these all anti-commute, right. So, if you exchange V1 and V2, right, B of V1, B of V2 will become B of V2, B of V1, right. That just picks up a minus sign, right. So, anti-commutation just follows from the anti-commutation relation of the B's. Okay. Any other question? Okay. And if you think about it a little bit, okay, this will also explain, okay, why we needed this condition on phi that it has to be annihilated by B0 minus B0 bar. Okay. Because these tangent vectors which correspond to rotating W, okay, you can show that those essentially amount to acting B0 minus B0 bar on the phi's. Okay. But those should be declared as 0 tangent vector, right? Because changing W, changing a phase of W, does not move you in PGN, right. So, those should be declared as 0 tangent vector and they better give you back the result 0 for this contraction. Okay. And that happens automatically once you impose that condition on phi that it should be annihilated by B0 minus B0 bar. Okay. So, that is the origin of the second condition on phi on the state in the Hilbert space. Okay. Are there any other questions? So, this defines omega, okay, but of course, there is a reason why you defined omega this way, okay, and the reason is that once you have defined omega this way, one can use a standard manipulation involving conformal field theory on Riemann surface and prove that this omega p has all the desired properties. Okay. So what are the desired properties? Okay. So here is the first one, that suppose any of the tangent vectors is zero tangent vector induced by reparametrization of one or more zi. Okay. That we can imagine that we choose the corresponding vector fields, right? We said that for every vi there is a vector field, right? But there are some choices of vector fields which are actually zero, right? Because those are induced by just reparametrizing the zi's. And I told you that those should represent zero tangent vector because you are not really moving in PGN. Okay. And one can show that if you pick a tangent vector which is of that kind, okay, then omega p automatically vanishes. Okay. This quantity that I defined, namely this quantity, okay, automatically vanishes. Okay. And you basically show it by deforming the contour integrals of the BRST of B, okay, and showing that the result cancels. Okay, so it's basically standard conformal field theory technique that allows you to do this. That whenever the vector field is induced by reparametrization of one of the zi's, okay, the result vanishes just by identically. Second condition is the most important one. Okay, this one, right? This identity again can be proven in general just based on that expression for omega that I gave. Okay, and identities in conformal field theory. Okay. I will not go into the details, but let me just point out the reason for this. Okay, the key result that allows you to do this, okay, which is that when you take the anticommutator of QB with B, you get back T. Okay. So essentially you want to show is that if we have an expression like this, okay, this involves contour integral of the BRST current, okay, you have to deform the contour integral, okay, through the B's and manipulate it. As you deform the contour integral through the B's, you pick up factors of T, okay, and what is T after all? Okay, T essentially generates a reparametrization, a motion in PGN. Okay, so that's the way we see that omega p of qbi phi is actually an exterior derivative acting on omega p minus 1. Okay. Why omega p minus 1? Because once you pick up a commutator, you have lost one insertion of b, right? So that's like a p minus 1 forming contracted. Okay. But you replace it by t, and insertion of t essentially gives you the d, exterior derivative operation, because this is what moves in the moduli space, okay, or in PGN. Okay. So this has to be done carefully, but this identity follows from standard conformal field theory analysis. And any questions? Okay. And finally, okay, that if we do pick phi to be a tensor product of BRST invariant states of host number 2, okay, which are the physical states, okay, then one can show that this integral with the definition of omega that I have given earlier, this integral over any arbitrary section, okay, gives you back the usual Onsell amplitudes in string theory. Okay. In fact, if you have never seen an expression for the Onsell S matrix element of string theory, okay, the usual Onsell S matrix elements, okay, this is it. Okay. You construct the omegas by this procedure by inserting vortex operators of the external states and this B ghosts, okay, and you integrate it over the section, okay, and what you get is what we normally call the string S matrix, okay, that you compute from this CFT correlation function, okay, which is of course good because you are trying to define off-shell amplitude, but they better have the property that when the external states are on-shell in the standard sense, they give you back the on-shell amplitude. Right? Otherwise, it's not an off-shell continuation of the usual on-shell amplitude. Okay. Are there any questions? Yes. The explicit form of omega, yes, it will depend on the choice of local coordinates, right? But that is basically in the choice of section, right? In here, the apparent dependence is on the choice of S. Because omegas are defined everywhere on PGN, right? Because in that case, omega being a form on PGN means that given a choice point in PGN, right, which implies that you have already chosen your local coordinate system. Okay, you define omega. So the dependence of the apparent dependence of this integral is in the choice of SGN, right? Over what subspace of PGN you are integrating over. Okay. But as we discussed last time, as long as the external states are BRST invariant, right, it doesn't matter what subspace you integrate over, you get the same result. Yes. Omega is unique, yes. This omega is, this omega is unique, right? This is a complete definition of omega. It tells you, given the tangent vectors, how to construct this P4. So there is no ambiguity in omega. Okay, omega is unique. What is non-unique is in the choice of the section, right? The section can be chosen in different ways. Okay, this is something this one should keep in mind. Omega, there is no ambiguity in defining omega. Okay, it's a P form on this big space. Okay, it of course depends on the choice of local coordinates. Okay, but that's just a statement that whether you define the P omega here or here, okay, you get a different result, right? Omega is a P form on this space. Is this point clear? Okay, so let's then go to the last task, which is choosing gluing compatible sections on PGN, okay, because this is what is needed for defining off-shell 1 PI amplitudes. Okay, so far whatever I have done, I have defined an off-shell amplitude, okay, but we didn't require any additional constraint like having this 1 PI formalism. So let me remind you that here the procedure is that we begin with 3 punctured sphere and 1 punctured torus, okay, because they are the simplest systems. Okay, why are these simplest? Okay, because if you look at the 3 punctured sphere, which is a sphere with 3 punctures, okay, and a torus with 1 puncture, you can easily convince yourself, okay, that these cannot be obtained by plumbing fixture of anything smaller. So in a sense, these are the basic building blocks. Okay, these are all one particle irreducible. Okay, so that's why we start with these. Okay, so we begin with 3 punctured sphere and 1 punctured torus. Okay, so the 3 punctured sphere has 0 dimensional moduli space, and the 1 punctured torus has 2 dimensional moduli space. Right, this 2 dimension is the modular parameter of the torus, the tau, okay, which takes value in the fundamental region. Now here, because these are 1 PI, okay, these objects, these are both 1 PI, we can choose local coordinates at the punctures arbitrarily, but not totally arbitrarily, you have to be consistent with symmetries. For example, exchange of punctures on the 3 puncture sphere, okay, should preserve this choice of local coordinates. And if you take, for example, this 3 puncture sphere, if you make an SL2C transformation that exchanges the punctures, okay, you should make sure that the local coordinates also get transformed accordingly. Okay, so that's what one means by exchange of punctures on the 3 puncture sphere. And similarly on the torus, okay, we have to be consistent in modular transformation. Right? If you take a point on the upper half plane and you go to another point in the upper half plane which is related to it by modular transformation, you should ensure that your coordinate system also gets transformed accordingly. Okay, but other than that, the choice is completely arbitrary. So let me remind you again that choosing specific local coordinate system corresponds to choosing specific sections of P03 and P11. Okay. In fact, P03, okay, this is a little misleading for P03 because M03 is actually a point. Right? M03 is a point, right? So P03 is in fact only vertical. Okay, it's an infinite dimensional space, okay, but there's no base direction. On this infinite dimensional fiber direction, you are picking a point. Okay, that's what we mean by choosing a section of P03. Okay. For P11, this is more representative because MGN is actually two-dimensional, right? So you have a section. Okay, we have chosen a specific local coordinate system for every value of tau, which means choosing a section. Okay, so we declared this to be 1 PI subspaces of P03 and P11. Okay, these choice of sections. Okay. And this means because you have declared all of them to be one pair Riemann surfaces. In this case, there is no difference between R and S. Okay. So R03 is the same as S03, R11 is the same as S11. Okay. R11, if you remember, we defined R as the 1 pi subspaces, S as the full section. Okay. In this case, everything is 1 pi. Okay, and hence S and R are the same. Okay, so let me remind you again what we said last time, that we said that if we have, say, in PGN, this is your PGN, okay, this is MGN, okay. We have a smaller part which I call RGN, okay, and the full section of course is bigger, okay. But the idea is that this dotted part, this should be obtained by gluing the lower Riemann surfaces, okay. So because these are 1 pi, these are 1 pr, okay. So there is a basic object which we call RGN, okay, basic part of the set of Riemann surfaces, and the rest are obtained by Plamin fixture, okay. Since 3 punctured sphere and 1 punctured torus, okay, cannot be obtained by Plamin fixture of anything else, we have to declare the whole thing as R. Is this point clear? But now let's consider 2 3 punctured spheres and glue them using Plumbing fixture. Okay, so take one puncture from each of the 3 spheres and glue them. Okay, so let me remind you that if W1 and W2 are the local coordinates around these punctures, then the Plumbing fixture is done by setting W1 W2 equal to Q, where Q is e to the minus S plus I theta, and you take S to range from 0 to infinity and theta to range from 0 to 2 pi. So all 4 punctured spheres that you obtain this way, you declare this to be 1 pr 4 punctured spheres. Okay. And you have to choose the local coordinates to be those which are induced from the 3 punctured spheres, okay, on this subset of 4 punctured spheres. And you have to repeat this for inequivalent permutations of the 4 punctures. So for example, if you mark the punctures as 1, 2, 3, 4, okay, if this is 1, 2, 3, 4, okay, you also have another contribution where it is 1, 3, 2, 4 and 1, 4, 2, 3. Okay, so those are the ST and U channel contributions, okay, or diametrically, you can, diagrammatically you can think of this ST and U channel diagrams. Okay. So these, the 1 pi, the 4 punctured spheres that we get by this Plumbing fixture, you declare as 1 pr, the rest you have to declare as 1 pi. Okay. So I will now write down some explicit expressions which will perhaps make it a little clearer. Okay. So suppose we take these each of the two 3 punctured spheres to be described by a coordinate system z1 and z2, okay, just as a plane. And let us suppose that the punctures are chosen to be at 0, 1 and infinity. Okay, we can pick them anywhere, but this is the standard notation that on a plane, you pick the punctures at 0, 1 and infinity. Okay, the 3 punctures on the sphere. And suppose that you have chosen the local coordinates around zi equal to 0 on each of these as wi equal to some function of z1, w1 as function of z1 and w2 as some function of z2. Okay, this function I am not specifying. It is some function that specifies the local coordinate system. It is easy to see from this that the Plumbing fixture relation, which was this W1 W2 equal to Q, gets translated to the following relation between Z1 and Z2. Okay, because after all, Z2 equal to 0 corresponds to W2 equal to 0, right? Z2 equal to 0 corresponds to W2 equal to, Z2 equal to 0, of course, we map to Z1 equal to 0. Okay, that's not the point. So let's see. So suppose we take arbitrary point in Z2 plane. Okay, then W2 is given by F of Z2. Okay, W1 will be given by Q over F of Z2. Okay, and Z1 is F inverse of W1. So Z1 is related to Z2 in this form. Okay, and now the question is, given this relation, where are the punctures in the Z1 plane? You could have also done it in the Z2 plane, but let us look at it in the Z1 plane. Okay. So you already had punctures at 1 and infinity, which are originally there. But now you have a puncture at Z2 equal to 1, which corresponds to, in the Z1 plane, a puncture here. Okay. And another puncture at Z2 equal to infinity, which corresponds to in the Z1 plane as a puncture here. Okay. So this gives a 4 punctured sphere, okay, where the punctures are at 1 infinity, F inverse of Q over F1 and F inverse of Q over F infinity. Is this clear? Okay, so you get a 4 punctured sphere this way. Okay. So this is again the repetition. I have just written the coordinates of the 4 punctures that we find that way. Okay. And now from this we can calculate the cross ratio, which is really the SL2C invariant combination, okay, which labels a moduli space of 4 punctured sphere. Okay. And basically once you have chosen the function f, okay, we see that as you vary, as you let q vary over the region where mod q is less than or equal to 1, which corresponds to letting s go from 0 to infinity, okay, we cover certain range of certain subspace of the x plane. Okay. Similarly, the T and U channel diagrams will cover other subspaces of the X plane, okay, which will be related to these by exchange of X2 and X3 and X2 and X4. Okay. So this is what I had said, that for the 4 punctured sphere, okay, the moduli space, so let's suppose we have here M04. So the S channel diagram covers part of the moduli space, the T channel diagram covers part of the moduli space, and U channel diagram covers some other part of the moduli space. Okay. So these you declare as 1PR 4 punctured spheres. Whatever is missing, you have to supply back. These you declare as a 1PI 4 punctured spheres. Okay. And in this explicit example, you can once you are given a specific choice of F, you can calculate explicitly what part of X space is covered by S channel diagram, what part of X space is covered by T channel diagram, and what part of X space is covered by the U channel diagrams. Okay, so you can explicitly identify these regions. Okay, so once you have done this, then on the 1PR 4 puncture spheres, you choose the local coordinates to be what is induced from the 3 punctured spheres. And on the rest of the 4 punctured sphere, we can choose the local coordinates arbitrarily. But again, you have to be consistent with the symmetries and continuity, and we declare them to be 1PI 4 punctured spheres. Okay, continuity means that we basically, if we have ended here, right, we don't want to start from here, right? We begin from here and go here. So local coordinates in the neighborhood of this should be close to what it was here. Okay, that's what one means by choosing it, maintaining continuity. Okay. Similarly, we can glue this 3 punctured sphere with 1 punctured torus. Okay, you can easily see that this produces a set of 2 punctured tori. Okay, so this has a topology of a torus with 2 punctures. We declare these to be 1PR, and we choose the local coordinates on these to be induced from the constituents. So this will cover part of the moduli space of 2 punctured tori, and we then declare the rest of the 2 punctured tori to be 1PI and choose local coordinates on these arbitrarily, maintaining symmetries and continuity. Okay. So this is basically the general procedure. You start from the simplest object, okay, and then we build the more complicated objects by plumbing fixture. Okay. Whatever is not covered, you declare as 1PI, and then you use those to produce even more complicated objects, okay, and go this way. Okay. And this way you can cover all the Riemann surfaces, and you can declare some of them as 1PI, the rest are 1PI. So this is what I have said here, okay, that we, by proceeding this way, we can choose gluing compatible sections. We identify part of the sections as 1PI subspace RGN, okay, and given this, the off-shell 1PI amplitude is given by integrating omega over this 1PI subspaces RGN, and the full amplitude of course is the integral of omega over the whole section SGN. Okay, so that's the basic story of defining off-shell amplitudes in bosonic string theory and off-shell 1PI amplitudes in bosonic string theory. Okay. So what we have to do tomorrow is to see how to generalize this to fermionic strings. okay, to super strings and heterodic strings. Okay. But the basic procedure will be very similar. Okay. Some of the technical details will be slightly different, but the basic procedure will be similar. Okay. Are there any questions? Yes. 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 No, there is no, okay. The point is that on a sphere, the number of punctures always has to be 3, right? There is no Riemann surface with less than 3 punctures. That is why 3 punctured spheres are elementary, right? And 1 punctured torus are elementary, right? There is nothing that you can do to build them from lower surfaces. So those are all 1 PI, okay, and then you build from there. Okay. So the only way to get a 4 punctured sphere from the plumbing fixture is by gluing 2-3 punctured spheres, right? There is nothing else that you can do. Yes. Yes, all possible channels, yes. So given a particular gluing, you have to basically sum over all inequivalent permutations of the external legs, right? Because the external legs are not are marked, right? Because you are inserting different states on different external states in general, external legs, right? So if you have something like this, if you have a Riemann surface like these are the punctures, right? These are the places where you are be inserting vortex operators. Okay. And those vortex operators are not identical states, right? You insert vortex operator 1 here, 2 here, 3 here and 4 here. Okay. So this is clearly distinct from this contribution, where you insert 1 and 3 here and 2 and 4 here. So you have to sum over all possible inequivalent permutations of the external legs. Exchanging these two is not inequivalent, right? Because you have chosen the vortex to be symmetric under exchanges. So 1, 2 here or 2, 1 here is the same. Okay. But 1, 2 here or 1, 3 here is clearly distinct. So you have to sum over all possible contributions. Okay. So all of these will contribute separate 1 PR, gives separate 1 PR contributions. And then whatever is left, you declare as 1 PI.
For the official 1 PI amplitude, well, say, suppose you compute the 1 PI amplitudes using that formula.
Yes.
And suppose that we concentrate on on-shell states.
Yes.
But does the choice of RGM?
No, it doesn't give anything nice. I mean, if you just take the 1 PI amplitude and focus on the external on-shell states, right?
But it seems like you get the
boundary when
you choose difference.
Yes. So the point is the result will depend on the choice of RGN. Right? See, for SGN we argued that it doesn't matter what SGN you choose, on-shell amplitudes are all the same. Okay? But on-shell 1 PI amplitudes are not all the same. Right? It's exactly as what happens in gauge theories. Right? Suppose you have done a particular gauge fixing. Okay. And now if you calculate the on-shell amplitude, okay, and instead of considering all possible Feynman diagrams, you just consider the 1 PI Feynman diagrams, the result will be gauge dependent. Okay. So on-shell 1 PI amplitudes are not particularly nice. Okay. So 1 PI amplitudes are useful, but not directly in this sense.
Maybe we should postpone our further question to the discussion session. So let's thank Ashok.